He's a great speaker as well. And he has been a team with the J.C. Cooley Foundation for a while. We have done several programs together, and I'm looking forward to do many, many more. I asked him to come in and enlighten the crowd, which he will, you will see. Let's get us energetic. Without any further delay, my very good friend, Hashimi!
All right, good morning. How y'all doing? Good, you waking up? Do you have your coffee yet? Is this your first cup? I've already had two cups of coffee, and I just got my third. I think I need a little bit of water. Thank you so much for that. I'm so excited to be here with you this morning, and hopefully you have a great time. You know, it's a privilege and honor to connect with James and what he's doing. It's great to see the foundation growing. Whether you're a student or an adult, I highly encourage you to get plugged in. Because, listen, James can't do it on his own. He needs people to help him. So as you feel led in your heart to connect on any level, I just encourage you to support him. Because I'll share my my little short snippet of my life with you after I do a couple songs. But, you know, if I had an organization like the James Cooley Foundation when I was in middle school, when I was in high school, man, it could have saved me from a lot of bad decisions. And so that's why I love connecting with this foundation, because we can empower our youth who James so eloquently shares are our future leaders. Do you agree with that? Yes? You guys are our future leaders, right? And so it's such an important thing to do. Got a couple songs with you for you, but I need you to participate with me, and I know you're eating, and I know it's early, but it's going to be fun. We'll have a good time together. So when the chorus drops, if maybe you've stopped chewing by that moment, you're just going to hopefully not blow food out, but you're going to say, blow, blow, okay? It's really simple, okay? I'm going to say, let the trumpets blow, and you're going to go, blow, blow, okay? And I'm going to say, let the people go, go. Go, okay? All right, I'm gonna give you a minute to chew because we're gonna try it together without the track, okay? You ready? This is my chance to drink some water. You guys go ahead and chew. Chew, chew. No, I'm like a train. All right, so let the trumpets blow, blow, blow. Let the people go, go, go. Let the trumpets blow, blow, blow. Let the people go, go. Go, you got it. Okay. You can be a little more convincing when the track drops, because, you know, there's energy when there's music, right? So this song is called Trumpets. Hope you enjoy it. Go ahead and drop that track, DJ. Let me tell you about the vision when I was in prison on an island. I stranded all alone with no one to call on. Heard a heavenly voice like a trumpet say, I am Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end. With eyes like a flame and a voice like the rain. It was like the sound of many waters, said I was dead. But now I'm alive, I got the keys to death. Yeah, I know what you got, yeah, I know what you say. Yeah, I know how you fly, yeah, I know how you pray. All up on those weak, innocent women and children. How you call yourself a Christian, but are you really from the synagogue of Satan? Talking all that game, son, in the tribulation. Making my mind meditate on the revelation. That's by grace through faith, we gon' be faithful to the end of this life. So let them trumpets blow, let the trumpets blow. Let the people go. 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 I am the catastrophe creation. The hallucination of hallucinations ran by out of denomination. I swear if I need to, I get reckless like I'm Haitian. Create more devastation than the Holocaust nations. Extraterrestrial invasions. Nope. Glorification, we will see the revelation. God's work needs no explanation. Heaven set my mind on the journey with like 12 of the acolytes. Dang right, I got an appetite and a vision of apprehension and coexistence. If I died, can I say I made a difference? I like to think so, but in the meantime, welcome to the abnormal bars, malarkey. So far elevated, contagious. like the doctor's patience. I'm anxious till I come up. Yeah, but in the meantime, we gon' let the trumpets blow. Let the people go. Let the trumpets blow. Let the people go. Let the trumpets blow. Let the people go. Let the trumpets blow. Let the people go.
All right, all right. You guys did good. Give yourself a round of applause. Y'all did good, man. You know, I'm a musician, so early morning concerts, man, that's only by the grace of God, you know. And because I love James and I love y'all, so great to be here with you today. I'm going to do one more song, then I'll share the message with you. And this song is called Electromagnetic, and it's a part, actually, of my message, because today I want to talk to you about three things that I didn't know were so pertinent to my life. And those three things are talent, time, and treasure. And it took a certain group of people to teach me that those things were important in my life, that I had talent and I had a certain amount of time to use it, and that as I used it, I would discover the treasures that were in my life. And so that, for me personally, happened because I met this gorgeous girl. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that story, but I thought I'd write a song about her, and this is called Electromagnetic. So also, you can participate with this one. This is even easier. All you got to do is repeat after me when the chorus drops. I'm going to say electromagnetic, and you're going to say electromagnetic. Okay, but you got to say it with some swag. Like, say it like you mean it. Okay, so electromagnetic, 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 electromagnetic. There you go. You got it. Let's go. I'm getting warmed up now. Listen, charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but the woman who fears the Lord is worthy of praise. Yeah, something about that girl who ain't even tripping, who laughs at the time to come. Yeah, I found the one that strength be her dignity, pray to the Trinity, works with the hands, always think about her man, laughs at the enemy, raising little mini-me's. That's my attraction, that's love's electricity. I feel that chemistry stronger than ever. I'm on my A game, I love her, I could love her a bit better. Listen, she love me too, she called me boo. Yeah, I feel that chemistry stronger than ever. I'm on my A game, I love her, I could love her a bit better. Listen, she love me too, she called me boo. I call her boo bear, cause I understand what that do. I'll buy her shoes, but she'd rather have me hold her and pray with her during rough times that she going through. She's a fine dime, gotta give her credit. Something about that girl, electromagnetic, electromagnetic, electromagnetic. There's something about that girl, electromagnetic. She's something like a phenomenon. Electromagnetic, electromagnetic. Something about that girl, electromagnetic, electromagnetic. She's something like a phenomenon. Electromagnetic, electromagnetic. Yeah. Yeah. Something about that girl got my mind elevated like I be smoking now. Hydroponic, kryptonic. Something about that girl got my life escalated like I be floating now. Something about that girl got me highly motivated. I be banging on this beat like an addict. Something about that girl got me highly motivated. I be rapping on this song cause she like it. Something about that girl got me running real fast. Got me thinking about the future, about how long will it last. Running through my mind, is she the real deal this time? Or another blast from my past? Looking to take up all my time, trying to make up, break up. They get me intoxicated like a strong gin and tonic. Is it cause she's exotic? I don't know what you think. Maybe something in my drink, man. I ain't even have a drink, there must be something about that girl, electromagnetic, electromagnetic, something about that girl, electromagnetic, electromagnetic, she's something like a phenomenon, electromagnetic, electromagnetic, something about that girl, you know, electromagnetic, electromagnetic, she's something like a phenomenon, electromagnetic, electromagnetic. Electromagnetic, electromagnetic. Electromagnetic, electromagnetic. electromagnetic, electromagnetic. She's something like a phenomena, something like a phenomena, electromagnetic.
Give it up for Big John, everybody. Helping me out. Couldn't do it without him. All right, so I needed my notes there. Well, I catch my breath there real quick. So do you remember the three keys to the message today? The number one thing was?
Talent.
Okay, nice. Number two?
Time.
Number three? Treasure. Awesome, man. Give it up for them over here. Nice. Paying attention. Wow. Awesome. Okay, so, you know, I love how James likes to open up with a word of encouragement, and so I wanted to kind of piggyback on that, and so while you take a little last bite and chew, give you a second here, we're going to do a little bit more of that, okay? Because I didn't know that these things were true in my life, and so hopefully today, if you know, I can reinforce that, and if you don't know, I'm here to tell you a few of these things. So I want you to repeat after me, okay? I am talented. No, like you mean it. Like you're looking in the mirror and you're about to go for a job interview or a scholarship interview or on a date, you know what I'm saying? Like homegirl electromagnetic, right? And you're like, man, I am talented. Dang, like homegirl, she blessed because you're going out with me, right? Okay, all right, you ready? So I am talented.
I am gifted.
I am creative.
I am
smart.
I am loved.
I am unique, and my favorite, I am one of a kind. Did you know that? Did you know that you're one of a kind? There's nobody else like you. Isn't that amazing to know that we are one of a kind? You could say that you're a masterpiece because, you know, my whole life growing up, I would look up to my favorite artist or whoever it would be at that time in my life, maybe if it was a friend that I looked up to or a family member, and I wanted to be like them, which is okay because you can aspire and be motivated by people who are doing great things in their life. But what I discovered is that when I realized that my gifting, my talent was unique and I couldn't really be like them, it really gave me a lot of freedom, especially in my artistry. And so today, I want to share just take a few minutes and share with you my life story. I was actually born in Tehran, Iran, which is the capital of Iran. It's in the Middle East. And we left the country when I was 5 because of the Islamic Revolution. My family was not Muslim. They weren't really of any kind of religious belief, but they didn't want to be a part of the Islamic Revolution because my mom's super hip and fashionable, and she likes to do her hair and makeup. You know, she actually had owned a salon in Iran, and now to this day, she owns a day spa. She just is about to celebrate her 25-year anniversary of owning a day spa in San Diego. And so she's like, I got to get out of here. So she grabbed me. I was 5 and my 9-year-old sister, and we moved from the Middle East to Paris, not California, but Paris, France. And so here I am, the 5-year-old kid who speaks Farsi, living in Paris, France, man. It was rough. It was rough, man. Talk about culture shock. And it took me about a year to learn the language, and I started getting settled in. And just when I was starting to feel like maybe like I could be a cool little French kid or something, boom, a year later, at the age of 7, then we moved all the way across the ocean. And we came to a place called Philadelphia, which I was not very familiar with, but we moved to Pennsylvania, Philly, to be precise. And so now I'm the 7-year-old Persian kid who speaks Farsi and French, but I'm living in Philly, right? And so, mind you, I had a rough couple first years, man. You know, how many of you know kids can be mean sometimes, right? And so, I either came home with a ripped shirt or bloody or scratched, but I'd be like, Mom, you didn't see him, though. I got him, man. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I kind of exaggerated that a little bit, too. But I didn't even know if they were picking on me, but I just felt like they were picking on me, you know, and so I was always on the defense. And then same thing, I took English as a second language, so English is actually my third language. And right when I started fitting in Philly and making some friends and feeling like, you know, this is it, you know, finally, boom, we up and we move from Philly to San Diego,
cross country, man. We drove all the way cross country, 4 nights and 3 days, and we ended up in San Diego, California. And so from the age of 9 all the way through high school, I lived in San Diego, grew up in San Diego. But to back that up just a little bit, about a year after we moved to from Philly to San Diego, my dad had a heart attack. He had a heart attack, and unfortunately, while we were playing tennis, he had cardiac arrest, and they tried to resuscitate him, but they could not. And so here I am now, this 10-year-old kid who lives in San Diego, who's been like across the world, and I'm just like feeling like things are starting to make sense, and I had my whole world rocked, right? And so I went through a lot of just emotional turbulence and not knowing what the purpose was in my life, not knowing that I was loved, not knowing that I was gifted, not knowing that I was talented, not thinking that I was smart. My mom always raised us with an immense amount of love, so I knew I was loved. And I think that's what really helped me through the hard times in life. But I didn't have a father figure. And so that's one of the main reasons why I'm so drawn to the J.C. Cooley Foundation, because as a youth leader, I found that we have so many young men who don't have father figures in their life. And how many of you know it's so important for men to learn from other men how to be a man? And so for me, I learned how to be a man from television, from music, from entertainment, from the radio, you know what I'm saying? So I would watch, you know, my favorite rapper or my favorite rock artist or my favorite, you know, movie or TV show, and I'd be like, okay, this is how I gotta be a man, right? And so I would do those things, but I discovered that those things weren't really rewarding in my life. And so it wasn't until I met the girl that I wrote you the song about, Electromagnetic, that she invited me to church. And I went to church, and I had no idea what Christianity was. I had no idea. You know, I didn't have any faith at all in God. But I went to church, and I discovered through this beautiful family that it wasn't God that had done those bad things in my life. But according to John 10:10, Jesus said, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But that I have come that you may have life, and that you may enjoy it, and have life more abundantly till it overflows. And I'm like, what? Like, this rocked my thinking, because this whole time I didn't understand. I was so confused. I didn't realize why I'd experienced these things in my whole life, that God had a plan for my life. And so when I discovered this, and I discovered that I was unique, it radically changed my life. And I was set free from the trap of comparison. And so today, as we talk about the fact that you are talented, I want to really encourage the youth to know that, man, it's okay to be competitive. You know, it's okay to challenge yourself. It's okay to strive for greatness. We're called to be great and do great things. But falling into the trap of comparison can cause paralysis in your life, because what it does is it causes you to say, I'll never be like that person. I could never achieve that. You're like, yeah, no, you're right. You're right. That's actually partially true, because you weren't designed like that person. You're designed completely different. You're designed uniquely and beautifully. And so I went on to learn that God not only loved me and that he sent himself in the form of Jesus to die for me, but that he had a plan for my life. And as I discovered that God had a plan for my life, I discovered that he had given me gifts and talents. According to the scripture, it says, do not be deceived, my beloved. Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting in shadow. And that's in the book of James, chapter 1. And so I realized that God had given me gifts and talents and artistry, and I started using them. But then I got to step 2. I realized that I had a certain amount of time, and that time was short, that I couldn't waste my time, that I had to be diligent in using my talent, okay? And so I want to really impress on you today that tomorrow is not promised to anyone, to make today count, right? And we're not talking YOLO here, okay? We're not talking like you only live once, so just like wild out and make stupid decisions. No, we're talking the exact opposite. We're talking you only got this life to live, so make the best of it. Do something great, man. Change the course of history through your life. Redeem the time. And so I found out that, for me personally, I found out that God had a plan for my life. And as I started being diligent over the little things, you know, as I started doing the small things. I started off just doing poetry. When I gave my life to God, I started writing poetry just out of nowhere, you know, and they were kind of like love poems to God. And before I knew it, the poetry turned into having a friend of mine play acoustic guitar, and we're doing shows, and people were like, how long you guys been together? I'm like, oh, just like yesterday. We like, you know, they're like, what? I'm like, I don't know. And so I started doing that. And then before I knew it, you know, we wrote a poem for a summer camp. They're like, hey, will you write another poem next year? And then all of a sudden it was a rap song. I'm like, how'd that happen? I got a rap song. And then before I know it, I got a band. And then before that, I'm traveling to other countries, traveling all over California, and opening up from some of the biggest bands that I looked up to when I decided to follow God's plan for my life. You know, I've got to play at the Storm Stadium and open up for bands like Disciple, and it's like hardcore rock band. Any rockheads in here, right? I've got to open up for some of my favorite rap artists like Trip Lee and Tadashi and Manifest, and the list goes on. This is not bragging. This is just discovering that God had a plan for my life and that I started using my time wisely. I discovered that then I would find my treasures, okay? And so we move on to the third point, which is treasures, is that your treasure is your purpose, a divine destiny. You could say you got a date with electromagnetic, or you could say that you got a date with destiny divine, right? And so we're called to do these great, amazing things, but sometimes we give up because we're like, man, like, it doesn't seem like I'm getting any results. But, you know, how many athletes we got in here? Let me see here. How many athletes you got here? Like, did you get good the first time you played the sport? No? Like, did you, like, develop big biceps the first time you lifted some weights? No. Like, it takes dedication. It takes perseverance. It takes commitment. And so that's one thing I learned, especially if there's anybody in here. Do you feel like you're an artist? Do you have artistic inclinations? Anyone in here brave enough to feel like they're an artist? Okay, she's an artist. All right. Artistry is the same way. The only thing that separates an aspiring artist from a professional artist, and the difference is that one does it as a hobby, and that's okay. That's okay. But another one does it, and they make their living from it, right? The difference between the professional and the one who's aspiring to be a professional, maybe, is not their talent. It's not their talent. It is their commitment to their craft. It's dedication, right? It is being creative when you don't feel like being creative, right? It's getting up and hitting the weights when you don't feel like getting up and hitting the weights. It's opening your books and studying when you want to scroll through your Instagram or your Twitter, right? Like, let's just be real. That's what sets us apart, is not necessarily the talent, because what I tried to share with y'all earlier is that each one of you is talented and gifted. But what you do with your talent in this short amount of time, which seems long, especially when you're young, but trust me, it goes by quick, right, James? It goes by quick. What you do in that amount of time with your talent will then uncover your treasures, okay? And lastly, I want to just close with this word of encouragement, man. Go big. Like, go big, you know? Dream big. You know, you look back, you know, in my lifetime, we didn't imagine this right here. Like, cell phones is not something that was in my life when I was in high school. In high school, right? And that's not that long ago. Like, cell phones are pretty new, right? Let alone smartphones, right? Somebody had to imagine this. Somebody had to dream this up, and then it came to pass. When we drove from Philly to Cali, we didn't have navigation, right? We had a map, like this stupid thing that you had to unfold like an accordion, and then you never knew how to fold it back up, and it was like, ah! I would just, like, crumple that thing up, you know? Like, we didn't have none of this, right? Just like, Siri, how do I get to, you know? Like, we didn't have that. It's amazing, right? But it took somebody dreaming big. It took somebody thinking out of the box, right? Some people say, think out of the box. I'm like, man, just get rid of the box. Just take that box, destroy it, and just get rid of it. Like, let's not even get in the box. Let's just stay out of the box. So hopefully I've encouraged you today. And the last thing I've got is some free giveaways. I want to get feedback here. I've got some free CDs if y'all are interested. Anyone want a free CD? For CD. Okay, so I had my last band for 7 years. It was called Blood Type G. We released 3 albums, and I've got 2 of them here. And then I launched a brand new band at the beginning of this year called Hashemi Music, and I have some free downloads available on SoundCloud as well. So I'm going to hand out some CDs, and I've got the cards with the download information on. If you want to connect with me on any social media outlet, I've got all my social media handles the same. They're all Hashemi Music, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook. Let's get it. Connect with me, because I want to help you. If there's any way that I could encourage you in life, man, maybe you just are going through a hard day and you want to send me a message and say, yo, man, pray for me. I'd love to pray for you. And I just want to encourage you, man, to go big, because did you want these? Did you already get these? All right. Is that like this was beyond my wildest dreams. Like, I couldn't imagine this happening, you know? And this is not to boast, but like, I'm holding in my hands like $20,000 right here. Like, that's what it costs to produce a good quality album. It's about $1,000 a song to record in a good quality studio. And so you add up all the songs here, and I'm not talking about the printing cost, I'm just talking about the recording cost, right? And I couldn't imagine these things, right? But I decided to just think big and believe big, and all of a sudden, like, I'd meet the right person, and it would lead to the next thing, and then it would lead to the next thing, and then all of a sudden someone's like, hey, I want to pay for your album. I'm like, yo, you know how much that costs? They're like, well, give me a couple quotes, and they go for the biggest quote. And I'm like, yo, we should have given them a bigger quote, you know? So this is not to boast in me by any means, but this is just if you like rap music, if you like rock music, just to bless you. I encourage you to put in your iTunes and then give it to somebody else, man, and connect with me. I'm going to do a song at the end, right? But give it up for James Cooley, everyone.
Hold on before you go. Now, notice he said 3 or 4 times to dream big, think big, and be big. There you go.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. That's what's up.
Dream big, think big, be big in everything that you do. Thank you, my friend. How everybody doing? You know, a lot of times, I sit back on Wednesday and try to figure out exactly what message I am going to deliver today, because I like to perfect the message. But, you know, this week, and I wrote the message, of course, but this week, I said the audience is already perfected. For one thing, the primary reasons why we are here today, of course, is to have a good time, but most importantly, is to make sure that our youth, especially our seniors, are focused, because there is a different journey that they are getting ready to take. How many seniors do we have in the house? Please stand up, please. Please stand up, seniors. Taylor, get up. And you guys are a little past senior, so you can stand up as well. Stand up. Just look around at each other. Now, you know, I'm going to be honest. After June, when you look around, and especially when you look at your parents, when you look at each other, after June, we're talking about graduation. The tides turn. Right now, you're all young men and young women, and we'll continue to be young men and young women. But once you walk down that aisle, the focus become a little bigger. We have to think a little bigger. Our dreams need to be a little bigger. Our decision making must be a lot more smarter, because some of you all are going to be going off to school, and guess what? Mommy and daddy cannot fit in your suitcase. Sit down. So today, my message that I want to talk about, I call it the ANA program. It's called Attitude and Accountability. Attitude and Accountability. Let's talk about, let me see, which one should I talk about first?
Attitude.
Okay. I like that. We're going to talk about attitude first. It has once been said that 95% of the things that happen to you, the decisions that you make, etc., is based on your attitude. Meaning, if, for example, one of your friends or someone you didn't know bumped into you, and you just turn around and just wham, without thinking about it, or without giving a little bit more thought, now you find yourself in trouble, that was because you had an attitude that wasn't adjusted. You know, so 5% of the things that happen to us, we have no control over. Someone crossing over, I hate to say it like that, on the traffic, head on, you didn't see it. But attitude, if we get in our mind right now that attitude is going to take us a long way, and we have to focus on, even when you wake up in the morning, if you wake up, I don't feel like getting up. I woke up on the wrong side of the bed. What is the right side of the bed? You wake up, sometimes we don't always be feeling good, right? But we know that there's certain things that we have to do. It goes back to the attitude. If we wake up, we force ourselves to be feeling good. We force ourselves because we wake up and we say, hey, I'm going to have me a wonderful day. If you wake up and say, homework again, school, I don't even want to go to Miss Jones' class. Actually, I'm going to take my time. Attitude. Attitude is everything. Every decision that you make in life is based on your attitude, good, bad, endeavor. I encourage you that when you're encountered with situations, like we all are encountered with situations, think about it. Use that split second. It took me a lot of years before I got there, where I used to react toward everything. Any little thing happened, react. Had to be done there. No thoughts. 95% of the time you do that, you make the wrong decision. So attitude is everything. It requires thought. Let's switch this over to accountability. Accountability is responsible for one's action, regardless what the situation is. We all are accountable. First of all, if you're a believer, you're accountable to the Lord or whichever God that you pursue, but you're accountable to somebody. Secondly, most importantly, you're accountable to yourself. Not mommy, not daddy, not little brother, not this. You're accountable to yourself, your actions. And with being accountable to yourself, you have to set the highest degree or standards to make sure that you are playing in a field within oneself that you can live with, not what anybody else can live with. Don't get caught up on other people's stuff. What you can live with. Now, so first of all, you're accountable to yourself. That does not mean that you're not accountable to others as well. I am accountable to you on how I react towards you and the things that I say. And you're accountable to him and each other. Being accountable to yourself, each other, and a lot of other things, that brings up this thing that we call manners and respect. Manners and respect. I'm going to be honest. I think that over the last 20, 30 years that we have lost a lot of those values. And especially in our youth right now. You all are the generation of tomorrow. I can guarantee you 100% certainty. Respect and manners will carry you a long way. Respect and manners will carry you a long way. When somebody do something for you, thank you. That could be a difference, because you don't never know who you're talking with or dealing with. You never know who you're talking with or dealing with. Thank you. Opening door for someone. I mean, young fellas, is that potentially. You all are going to grow up, you're going to date, and you know, the young ladies still like those values. They like the door being open for them, and they like you helping them in the car and all that other type of stuff. If you ain't doing it, get it back. Young ladies, I'm not going to let you off the hook either. Guys like to be complimented, you know, even on the little things. Just like you all like those little things, they like those little things as well. So let's get back. That's where the manners and the respect, we can start. We can start today. We don't have to be all tough and hood. No, I ain't going to. You crazy, man. Now we got to get back down to the little things. And people are always watching you. Everything that you do, you might not believe it, but someone is always watching you. Parents, accountability, and respect. We all know that we are accountable to and for the actions of our kids. We know that. Therefore, we had to make sure that we push the responsibility down to them, even at a young age, of that what is right and what is wrong. Most of us know what's right and what's wrong. Yeah. So, how do we become more affected in what I call the ANA, accountability and attitude? I believe in this thing called the four C's. I believe that the four C's will prepare us for anything. Stop, Taylor. It will prepare us for anything. Can I get the four C's? I want everybody to listen to this. I wrote this because I really believe that this is one of the keys to success, keys to life, keys to being focused, keys to... You know the four C's? First of all, we're going to find out. Alexa, you know what the four C's are?
Great. Commit, create, collaborate, and commit with confidence.
Oh. Wow. You know, in a minute, I mean, it's important. We're going to play this. I want everybody to know the four C's, not just because of me, but I tell you, if you remember it like this, you understand that create, collaborate, commit with confidence. I'm going to explain that, how that's going to help you in life. Can we get it? Can we get it? We're only going to play a little bit of this. A little more volume, please.
Don't realize that we can affect an entire generation.
Please, four C's.
But you got to do it with these four C's.
Create, collaborate, Then you commit with confidence. Create, collaborate. Then you commit with confidence. It's the four C's.
Everybody know what the four C's are now?
It's the four C's.
Up.
In this life, you're gonna grow, but there's things in this world that you gotta know. To be the best that you can be, you wanna grow real big into a strong tree. To be who you were.
The four C's: create, collaborate, commit with. Let's say it together. Create, collaborate, commit with confidence. Okay, with confidence. I'm going to come back to that one. As we talk about accountability and attitude, we are born with what we call birthrights. I talk about this all the time, so a lot of y'all know. We all have the exact same birthrights. Anybody remember what the birthrights are? Confidence, courage, hope, belief, and most importantly, faith. Those are common birthrights. And you also are born with something that makes you uniquely different than the next person. Like DJ, you born with something, you and your mother and your father born with the same birthrights, but then you are born with something that makes you uniquely different than both of them. That is the secret sauce. And we all got that. So how does this ties into the four C's? I'm going to tell you in a minute. But we're born with these things because we have our own destiny. We have our own destiny. We are all born to do great things. And all the ingredients that we need is already inside of us right now. But the problem that we have is we don't look inside to figure out how we're going to unturn that stone or whatever that might be so we can find out our sole reason for being here. It's there. So, creativity, 4C, create. Create means being able to see things past the tip of your nose. You might not be able to see it with your eyes.
If you can visualize it,
you can do it. If you can visualize it, create creativity. Creativity. We all have thoughts. We all have our own mind. We all have our own ideas. We all have big dreams. Creativity. Collaborate. Create, collaborate. It's getting together like we're doing right now. Talking. Sharing our ideas. You know, hey, I didn't know that you was thinking that way, too. Well, no, I was thinking that way, too. Well, did you think about it this way? No, I didn't. Did you think about it this way? You just built each other up. You might have been missing a small piece. Collaborate is communication. It's communicating with each other. All for a common purpose, which I think is love and compassion and making the world better, making the people around you better. So create, collaborate. When you're doing all these things and you come up with these ideas on how we're going to make things better, we commit to a common set of goals. We commit to making sure that we're going to do the right thing so we're prepared for college. We commit to make sure that we are walking right in life. Walking right in life meaning that you might have a couple of friends, my high school, couple of friends, that's out there, want to do the bad things, smoking dope, want to drink, want to do all these things. And you know one mark against you can derail everything. So you have to commit to being able to push them to the side. Commit to doing the right thing. So create, collaborate, commit. But when you commit and you have all of these ideas and you have these plans, got to be a plan. You have this plan. Commit with confidence, meaning that you can do it. You don't just commit. Can you do it? Yeah. We're going to get it done? Yeah. We're going to get it done. No. Are you going to average 19 points a game next year?
Yes.
Say it like you mean.
Yes.
Basketball point star right here. So yes. But how did he supposed to say it? Yeah. Yes. Commit with confidence. Create, collaborate, commit with confidence. When you do all of these things, that leads, that gives you a better attitude, that makes you more accountable for your actions. Sound like a preacher over here, right? I make you a little bit more accountable for your action. And it gives you this thing called focus. 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 Vision. I talked about vision, which is part of creation. Vision is being able to see past the tip of your nose. When you have these visions, you have to turn that into understanding. But the key ingredients to all of these things is focus. Focus. I'm going to stop the message right now because I'm going to come back later and finish it off. But we got some other things that's coming up right now. I want to turn my floor over to my seniors. I have identified a few seniors to come up and tell a little bit about themselves and come up and share some experiences that they might have had or might have been wondering. And our youth guest speaker today, one of my primary youth guest speakers, she's going to come up and talk to you all about potentially how it feels to be walking in another one's shoes. Listen to this. I think you're going to learn something. Without any further delay, Monterey Billings.
All right. Hi, everybody. I'm Monterey. I'm 17, and I'm a senior right now. I'm going to be graduating in about a week or so. And right now I'm actually going to Palomar Community College. I'm taking my high school classes there. And it's counting towards high school and college. And then I'll be transferring over to a university and hopefully major in nursing. So JC asked me to speak. And when I found out that I got to pick the topic, I immediately thought of walking in another person's shoes. I was kind of confused when I thought of this because I'm not that great at it. but, like, I'm the type of person that sees my friend crying or something and I'm like, hey, suck it up. Like, why are you crying right now? Like, really? I know I should be more compassionate about this and be nicer and everything, and I know that that's something that I need to work on. But I recently did an exercise with a group of random people, kind of like today. And the main speaker had everyone take their shoes off and put them in a pile in the middle of the room. We were all sitting in a big circle. And then you had to grab someone else's shoes, go back to your seat, and put the shoes on. It was kind of funny because I watched who grabbed my shoes. And she grabbed my flip-flops, and she put them on. And she immediately had this face of, like, disgust. And I was like, what? Like, what's wrong with that? And then I heard her, and she turned to her friend. She was like, this is disgusting. These person's shoes are sweaty. And I was so confused. Like, what? No. Like, I don't have sweaty feet. And then I realized that I left my flip-flops out in the rain that night. And so, and I must have not have realized it because I was such in a hurry to, like, get to the place. And then she put on my wet shoes, and she was just grossed out. So I was already embarrassed, like, oh, geez, like, don't look at me, you know, because she doesn't know that they were out in the rain. And then to make it even worse, the speaker saw that she wasn't wearing the shoes and asked her in front of the whole entire group, "Why aren't you wearing that person's shoes?" She was like, "This is disgusting. Whoever owns these shoes has nasty, sweaty feet." She literally said that, like, in front of everyone. I was like, oh, great. Like, buried my face even more. And then I decided to speak up, and I was like, "Those are mine. Like, they're not sweaty, I promise. They're just out in the rain." So once that was off my plate and I was able to not worry about that anymore, I kind of looked down at the shoes I was wearing and started to think about them. And I was wearing a pair of really worn down heels that actually fit me. I started to look around at everyone else and the shoes that they were wearing and the looks on their face, and they all had the same expression. They all felt compassion. You could just tell that each person, as they put on those shoes, just felt like this love and this connection for those people. It was so crazy. Who would have thought that just putting on someone else's shoes would do that to you? It's like you're actually stepping into their life and actually like feeling what they feel and what they go through. When you kind of start to think about like, what is this person? What is this person's trials? What are they going through? Well, sorry, I'm kind of lost. I tried to figure out whose shoes I was wearing, and I was looking around, and didn't take me long to realize that there was a woman who was kind of staring at me and like my shoes that I was wearing, and I figured they were hers. She was probably in like her 20s, and sorry, I'm totally lost. All my notes are kind of crazy. Thanks. So once you put those shoes on, you could just feel all those selfish thoughts literally like be lifted off of you. It was really crazy. I started to immediately feel my thoughts about my sweaty feet and what people were thinking about me and stuff just be lifted off of me, and my thoughts were completely like onto this woman and what she's going through. I started to look around the room and thinking about everyone and their stories and all their problems that they must be facing. And from then on, I decided to not be so quick to judge other people and to think more in their minds and walk in their shoes a little more. So I want everyone to kind of look around the room right now. Just look all around, see, like, look at everyone who's in here. And now stop thinking about what they might be thinking about you, but think about what they're going through and their trials and who they are. Now, who knows what people are going through? You never really know. Like, maybe his mom died 2 months ago. Maybe she's being bullied at school. Maybe he's suffering through depression. Who knows? But I know that I often get caught up, everyone gets caught up in our thoughts, and we don't stop to talk to the girl who looks sad or smile at the boy who looks like he's going through a hard time. I know it's scary to take that first step, but you have to think, would you be offended if someone stopped to say hi to you or to just smile at you? Let's focus on smiling for a second. How hard is it to literally just smile? Like, it takes like half of a second. Like, it's so easy to just smile. Exactly, yeah. Like, literally smiling can change a whole person's mood around. Just if you just are walking down the street and you see someone and just smile at them, all of a sudden their mood is like, whoa, like, that's so crazy. Like, that person just smiled. Like, they're so happy. I should be happy too, you know? It just, like, is so contagious, like you were saying. I read a study about a few months ago, and it said that you could be in the worst of moods, but just by smiling, it actually improves your mood. Imagine if every person in this room, once this was over, walked out of here and smiled at least 3 people every day. Imagine how much happiness would already be spreading around this town or wherever you live. I have a few quotes that I'd like to share. The first one is by Mother Teresa, And it reads, I alone cannot change the world, but I can cast a stone across to create many ripples. I love this quote because she's definitely right. Not one person can change the world, but you can definitely try to create as many ripples as possible. Just make sure that those ripples are for the good intent. The second quote is unknown, actually, but it says, you are not just here to fill background space or be a background character in someone else's movie. Consider this. Nothing would be the same if you did not exist. Every place you have ever been and everyone you have ever spoken to would be different without you. We are all connected and we are all affected by the decisions and even the existence of those around us. The first time I read this, it really hit me hard. I had to think about this concept for a little while. I even had to reread it a few times. I'll reread it again, actually, in case some of you guys didn't pick up on that. I know it's kind of long, but you are not just here to fill space or be a background character in someone else's movie. Consider this. Nothing would be the same if you did not exist. Every place you have ever been and everyone you have ever spoken to would be different without you. We are all connected and we are all affected by the decisions and even the existence of those around us. I like where it says we are all connected and we are all affected by the decisions and even the existence of those around us. So just like it says in that quote, just like Mother Teresa says, everything we do, whether for good or for bad, we affect people. Even if we don't realize it, we are making an impact on someone else's lives and the choices that they make. So wouldn't you want to be the person that starts that ripple effect for good and the person that can make someone else smile or have a happier day? Don't you want to be the one that helped change the world for good just by thinking about someone else and walking in another person's shoes and realizing that it's just important to care for other people as it is to care for yourself? I hope that one day we can all overcome our selfish thoughts and think about others more. And that's it. So I hope that we can all do that.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you, thank you, thank you. As I mentioned, we got several of my seniors coming up and gonna share their story. This next young man, I have had the pleasure of watching him grow up for the last 5 years. I can't believe today, you know, he done went from, you know, being that little boy to, a big man, not fat, but condition, you know, caring, and I tell you, this Gregory Hope is epitome of leadership. He is. Great guy, great personality, and every time I see him, even from this little boy to now, always focus. 3.5 or better. He's on his way to Tufts University, the Defensive Player of the Year in the CIF. Defensive Player of the Year. I mean, that's out of everybody. You know, I asked Greg to come up and share a little bit about you know, what his goals are for the future and some of the things that he keyed out on how he is here today to be able to continue that goal. Without any further delay, Greg Hope Jr.
All right, hey guys, I'm Greg Holt. As he said, he asked me to come in and talk about a little bit about goal setting, and I'm going to talk about goal setting and then also how it's impacted my high school career and then a little experience I had last summer that's kind of shaped the way I'm going to live the rest of my life. I'd like to thank Mr. Cooley for allowing me to speak and being such a tremendous person to look up to throughout the community, and then my parents for everything they've done for me as a person and all the sacrifices they had to make, and then God for just making all things possible and blessing all of us. So as he said, next year I'll be going to Tufts University in Boston. I'll be playing football there, and I'm really excited. I'm kind of scared to go all the way across the country, living in California my whole life. Parents kind of baby me, so I'm really excited to get out there and do my thing. So when he talked about goals, my high school career, I've always wanted to play college football. I've always been only 5'10". If you guys see linebackers on TV, they're normally 6'2", 6'3". I'm not 6'2", 6'3". So everybody's kind of always told me, like, oh, like, you're too small. You won't really make it. So you have to set goals in order to, like, shoot all those people down. And it's kind of motivation. I like when people tell me that I can't do something, because you really just take it and, oh, I'm going to work that much harder to do it. So my junior year, I had goals of making, like, All-CIF, All-State. I didn't make All-State my junior year, but, like, so I knew going in my senior year I'd have to set certain goals. So going to my senior year, I said I wanted to be the strongest on the team. I wanted to be defensive MVP in the CIF and league. I wanted to make an All-State team, and I wanted to lead the state in tackles. So I knew that in order to reach a goal, you have to do a certain amount of things in order to get there. So I knew that I had to wake up. I would wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go work out before school. And then on, like, Saturday nights and all my friends were going out, my version of going out would be going to get an extra leg day in order to be the strongest next year. So it really just taught me that, like, nothing's given to you. Like, if you want something, you have to go get it. No one's going to help you get it. And so with that, my senior year, I was league and CIF defense player of the year. I was Cal High and Max Prep's first team All-State. I finished first in the state with 209 tackles, and I was the strongest on the team with a combined lift total of over 1,700 pounds. Thank you. I don't know, it just taught me, like, when you know that you've worked hard for something, when I was on the field, like, all my teammates wouldn't say I'm cocky, but I was just really quiet, and I was only like that because I knew, like, I prepared more than the person in front of me, and I knew how hard I worked, and I knew that it wasn't just for me. Like, God gave me the ability to work hard. God gave me the ability to have the people around me, and so that was kind of a motivation on the field, was I want to work hard for the people around me and know that I've worked hard and that it'll all pay off if I just do my thing. So, yeah, goals have been a huge part of my high school career. It's something that I'm going to set in college. I've already started setting my college career goals, and so I'm really excited about that. And then I just have a little story that kind of, like, forms my life now. So last summer, I had the opportunity to go to Haiti with 13 kids from my school. And so, like, when you think about going to Haiti, you think about the big earthquake they had and how, like, it's disastrous, and you think about a lot of poverty. And so as I'm getting ready to go on this trip, I'm just thinking, like, wow, this is going to be a different world. I grew up here where we have everything we get. We can go to the store and get water. We can go to the, like, fast food place and get something to eat. But when I got to Haiti, like, I landed, and all you see from up above is, like, a bunch of little shacks. And then you get inside the airport, and you're like, oh, like, this isn't too bad. And then you walk, and there's no more AC, and then you're just sweating the entire time. And it's just humid and hot, and you're like, wow, this is not fun. And so then you get outside the airport and you walk out, and it's just, like, it's havoc. And they ask the guys to, like, protect the girls because, I mean, there's not a lot of, like, well, let's say just white people in general in Haiti. So I was probably the only person of my skin complexion, and then everybody else is different. So, like, we stick out. Like, you can tell where we're from. And so we kind of got out there, and we're walking, and there's buses, and everybody's yelling, and none of us speak Creole. We know, like, a little bit here and there just, like, to barely communicate. And we get on this bus, and we drive 2 hours to a city called Hinch. And it's, you're sweating the entire time. There's no AC in Haiti, I can tell you that much. And then we get to our little compound, and we kind of set up. And we have, like, the compound we live on is kind of nice. It was like a nice little house thing. No AC in the rooms, once again. So at night, I slept with no covers, and I just lay there and sweat until I fall asleep. So, I mean, it's a good workout. But so the reason we went... The reason we went to Haiti was for a VBS, which is a vacation Bible school we put on for local kids of the community. And so the kids didn't, it was only a 3-day VBS, and we were there for, like, 9 days. And so the kids didn't come up for, like, until the third day. And so they all get there, and the entire time you're running around and sweating more and more as you're running around and playing soccer. And you can't speak the same language as the kids, but you're on the same, like, you can just tell that you guys love each other. Like, that's the one thing that Haiti's taught me is, like, love is the purest form of joy. And I've never received that in such a way until I met these people who I couldn't even speak the same language as. But I love them so much anyways, and they love me. And so that kind of leads me into, like, the main part of the story. After all the kids left, we had 2 days left, so we had to clean up. And then we'd get in the back of trucks, and you just stand in like truck beds and hold on to like railing, and then there's no driving rules in Haiti, so you could just be driving, and then someone will be driving right at you, and then eventually you'll swerve off and get out of the way. And so, I mean, it's a little scary. It's not normal, but I mean, it works for them. So, and then you'll just be driving up these like stiff like cliffs and stuff, and there are people be hanging off of trucks on the edge of a cliff and just kind of like hanging out, and you're like, okay, like that's the normal. Yeah. So then we drive and we're going through the village, and you see kids riding on bikes with no, like almost everybody there has no shoes, and they're riding on bikes with no shoes. They got to bike 3 miles to go to a well to get water, and then carry two jugs back and make like 4 trips a day. So you're just driving, you see stuff like that. You see chickens hanging off of them. You see chickens hanging off of like motorcycles, and you're like, oh, are those alive? And then you hear them screaming and stuff. And so you just see crazy stuff. The things you smell, I mean, I can't really compare it to anything. It's not good. It smells like no one's ever taken a shower. And like you see the river and people are bathing in it, but the river's brown and like people are washing their clothes in it. And I live here where I have like a washing machine and like a clean shower. And so you're just kind of going through a culture shock. And then we're driving and we pull up to like, it's probably like a little, that's like a shack row. So like, it's just a row of shacks. And we pull up and we're supposed to be meeting a man named Roberto. So everybody's been talking about him. They're like, oh, this guy's amazing. Like, he's awesome. So I'm expecting like a big guy who like helps out the community and everything. But when I walk up, Roberto is a double amputee who is 95% blind and is missing almost all of his fingers. And so what he basically does is he has, like, you know, guys, like a Nike slipper he probably found that's kind of torn up. And so he has one of those, and he holds one in his hand, and he, like, moves his knee onto it as he hobbles around. So he doesn't move very well, and he can't see. And so we walk into his house, which is no bigger than, like, a walk-in closet. So it's like, all metal shack walls. And we walk in, and there's, like, 12 of us, so we didn't really fit. And his main concern was that we were all comfortable, and that's crazy to me, because the guy has nothing and he can barely walk, and his biggest concern is that we're all comfortable. And so we had a translator, and they're talking to him, and he said he feels bad for other people because they can't sing the way he can in order to praise God. And like, when you just think about that, like, the guy can't do anything but sing, and like, he's just so excited to be able to praise God. And like I just took that. I was like, wow, like, this place is crazy. Like, this guy's amazing. And then there's a little story of him, and I'll just say this one quick. It was like, I guess it was night, and he heard that somebody down the street had lost their mom. So he's blind. There's no lights in Haiti, so no street lights. It's dark. He lives on like a little bridge. And I guess he got up at like midnight and hobbled over to these people's houses just so he could pray for the family. I was surprised he made it back. Like, it's not like a safe place, I guess you could say. But Roberto just taught me, like, life is so short, and we're supposed to enjoy it. And if you can show someone love, take the time to do that. Because I think, like, to me, I've taken into life that love is one of the most important things that I've ever in my life. And the people around you and the way you can impact them, and not to take anything for granted, because we're all so blessed. And things that you would see in other countries that doesn't seem real, like, we have so much, and there's so much to be thankful for, and just to spread the love and share it. Because in the end, like, we're all living for a bigger purpose here than we see, than just what's around us. We're living for God, and that's such a bigger purpose than all the little things that we worry about here. So that's kind of my story.
Amazing, man. Let's give him another round of applause for that. All right. I want to bring my next senior up. And, you know, he don't know it, but I call him the doctor of service. This guy volunteers for everything, been on several missions, not just this year, but last year alone. A true giver, in the sense where he's willing to just go anywhere and help out. Been to Mexico a few times, just got back from Peru, several mission trips. And speaking of mission trips, the J.C. Cooley Foundation is a part of a mission trip beginning the 27th. This month, 2 weeks, we are going to Rocky Point, Mexico, and we're going to be at 2 houses in 72 hours. And we leave on a Friday, we build it on Saturday, and we present the keys to 2 families that do not know anything about it on Sunday right before we leave. We still got room for anybody who want to volunteer, and I got the information as it relates to that. But I want to bring Evan. Evan has been part of the program for the last couple of years. I met him, actually, I spoke at the school last year and gave a scholarship, couple of scholarships away, and ran into him about 3-4 months later. I think it was in Office Depot, and he came up and said, ah, you're that guy that spoke. But, you know, we've been involved ever since, you know, making sure that some of the things that he does. But I want to bring Evans up because I think the gift of giving and understanding service is one of the most important things in life. Evan Elliott.
Hello, everybody. I am Evan, as he has said. Thank you, Mr. Cooley. I respect this man very much so. So thank you for allowing me to speak again. I'm glad that I didn't do that terrible last time. So I am not exactly a normal person. So my dad, my grandfather, 7 uncles, 12 cousins, and 13 close relatives are pastors. I come from an extremely religious family, and my dad is not exactly a normal man. My dad has had his arm ripped off. He is and sewn back on. He has been shot. He has been hit and run over by a tractor, and he dropped out of Navy SEAL training because he blew his knee out and then became a pastor. So I come from a very strange family. My mom has survived a head-on collision with a semi-truck, and my great-grandfather was the only survivor of a B-17 bomber in World War II that collided mid-air with a German bomber. My family is, for all intents and purposes, indestructible. I have fallen off of 3.
Wolverine.
Seriously, right? So I myself have fallen off of 3 cliffs while rock climbing. Yeah, so that sucks. If you ever want to fall off a cliff, don't. It sucks. It's terrifying. I hate that. Yeah, so that's pretty scary. I was surfing once and fell into a water and looked to my left, and there is a leopard shark. That is terrifying. Never go surfing with a shark. If you do, please wear chainmail. Chainmail is life, especially when you have sharks. I've never been bitten by a shark. My friend has. That was scary. I pulled him out of the water. I've been to 5 countries on missions trips. I've been to Mexico, I've been to Peru, I've been to Haiti, and then I've been to Venezuela. All these places are extremely scary. Actually, I have been shot at twice, once in Mexico, once in Peru. Is anybody here in the military or has been? All right, well, if you have been, if you have been shot at, it is terrifying. I do not want to do that again. Oh my gosh. I have fired firearms before. I have been hunting. My father lived in Oregon. He taught me from a very young age, Evan, this is how you take apart a weapon, this is how you use it, and this is how you don't shoot somebody. I said, thank you, Dad. So, yeah, being shot at is very scary, but I've been all over the world, mainly in South and Central America. So not all over the world, mainly south, I guess, in a straight line. So that's not really that impressive. anyway, so my goal in life is to become a specialist field surgeon in emergency medicine. My main goal, I can't actually pronounce the job title, but it specifies in shrapnel-based injuries. I wanted to join the Red Cross eventually. I decided I wanted to do this when I went to Peru just a while ago. I knew I wanted to be an EMT, but I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do. We were walking around the main square in Lima, Peru, which is the capital city. And in Lima, Peru, they have a huge cathedral. The cathedral is massive. It's a beautiful building. But surrounding it were 4 armored cars and lines of riot police. Because in Peru, there is a massive communist rebellion. Huge. Hundreds of thousands of people are killing each other in Peru because they want to support communism. And Peru is one of the last republic-based nations left in South America. Most of them are now socialist or communist. They are also the second wealthiest nation in South America, which is sad when you go there because you see they're not wealthy at all. It's pretty sad. But while I was there, you see how actually hectic it is because you're walking around the main square and I see there laying there is a guy who's laying on his back trying to drink water from a straw, and he has no arms and no feet. So I asked this guy, hey, what happened to him? And apparently he used to live in the jungle He was brought to Lima, and the reason why he was there, why he lost both of his arms, is because he refused to give food to rebels. So they took a machete and they hacked off his arms. And so the government brought him and put him in the square to show people not to support the communists, because that's what's going to happen. So that's why he was there. He was there as propaganda for the government. It was pretty sad. So it's a really sad place. It's extremely hot, extremely humid. However, if you guys ever want good chicken, go to Peru. There are several good things about Peru and its chicken. I don't have much time to talk, but I can tell you that there are very few things that you can do in the plant. You can really do them in a short amount of time you're given. One of the most important things is to help people. Do something with your life that will affect others. If you can affect one person's life for the better, you've done enough to affect 300 lives. That's all you need to do is affect one life. Focus on one person. That's fantastic. Focus on five. That's even better. Your goal in life should be to help people, should be to build people up. And if that means taking yourself down and making sure that you don't look as great as they do, do it. Your job isn't to look good. It's to make other people's look good, to make sure they go to bed with a smile on their face, to make sure they go home and give their mom or their dad a hug, to be there when they're sad and to be there when they're alone. And that's all I really have to say.
Thank you, Elliot. Wow. We got some extraordinary seniors in here, dude. Hey. I want to introduce you guys to this next senior who's also been working with the J.C. Cooley program. This guy's very talented. He does a lot, not just with my program, but with Millard and with everybody else. And he's a video film guy, extraordinary. I mean, just the producer of a couple of new releases that myself and Millard got coming out as well. And this guy is in high school, 17 years old. Without any further delay, let's bring George Ellis up to the floor.
Hi, everyone. Testing mic check 1, 2, 3. How does it look, John? All right, we're doing good. I have to edit this footage later, so George, make sure you don't clip anything. Remember that. I leave myself notes. As you can tell, my name is George. I go to River Springs with, where'd he go? Elliot, I don't know where he went. I also take classes at Mount Sinai Central College to get my dual enrollment out of the way. And I am going to be going to UC Riverside in the fall for neuroscience. And long story about that, and I'm going to get into it. What I want to talk about is your why. Why are you doing these things? And for me, my reason is my little brother, since, almost since 2005, no, since 2005, has had epilepsy and autism. You know, he'll have a seizure in the middle of the night, and it's, you know, scary, to say the least. And, you know, he's been with me thick and thin. One time when we were little, we were climbing apple trees, and we were throwing them at my little brother so he could catch them. So that's, you know, we love each other to no end. And what I want to say about your why is, what is your reason? You know, for people, they could have a religious reason. I want to do something. I want to do this for God. I want to do this for, you know, for Jesus. Some people have a money reason. They want to make, you know, $250,000 a year. They want to make $10 million a year. Hey, nothing wrong with making money, especially nowadays. But for me, my reason is my brother. And when your why becomes bigger than you, you become, you know, indestructible. You become like a bulldozer. Nothing stops you. And yes, it is, when all you said, ooh, yeah, neuroscience, it's hard. It's very hard. But would I replace anything for it? No. Because I want to be able to see my brother someday. I want him to be able to drive a car. I want him to be able to find someone, and, you know, I want to see mini Pauls. But little me, it's electromagnetic. But you know, it's you need to find your why. You need to find your reason as to do things. And as James and Milad say, I'm the video guy. I do all the videos, and the reason why I do that is I love telling stories. You know, I lost my aunt, my dad's sister, last July, and I lost my dad's brother-in-law this January. And To this day, I have interviews with them that are invaluable. Without those interviews, our whole tree, our whole history of the family would have been gone. That's my why. I want to preserve and I want to record these memories for the future so that future generations can enjoy them. And I don't know, is it time or what is it? It's cool?
Yeah.
It's cool? I was nervous up here if you couldn't tell.
You know, sometimes we have to put the video guy in front of the video. Hey, some magnificent seniors. I wish I could get through all of them today. The next senior, and I know she's probably a little mad at me a little bit because she did not know she was going to speak until she came and sat down and was eating and looking at the program. Taylor Norma is the president of Chaparral Black Student Union, and she's also the face of my program for the last 2 years. And Taylor will be attending. Before we do this, I'm going to identify a lot of things. Taylor will be attending Spelman University. Yes. Tabitha will be attending UC Davis. Stand up. DJ will tell you what he's going to be attending in a few minutes. As you know, Greg is attending Turk in Boston. I didn't get it right. Tough. And I don't know if you're a junior. You're a junior this year. Ray, she's in college. She was kind of a little humble right now, but she's in high school and college at the same time. And she's doing extremely well, so she's going to be able, I think she's looking at Brigham Young in Hawaii. Yes, so, but in our program, the six seniors that we have in the J.C. Cooley program, all six of them have received four-year colleges or appointments, and all four. So we say Boston University, West Point, UCS Davis, Spelman, Clark, etc. We everybody going somewhere. But anyway, Taylor is hoping that I forget to bring her up here. Taylor is passing the throne down next week to her presidency to two other young the twins, Miracle and Michael, that. The program will become very familiar with these two. They are superstar athletes. Michael is on today. I think he's at USC or UCLA. One of these doing a visit. Miracle is in the CIF today. She's a runner. Twins, and both of them are 3.5 or better. And they will assume the president and the vice president of the program. Right now, the current president and vice president, Taylor is the president. Can you come on up, Taylor? And DJ is one of the vice presidents of the program, along with Hannah. Without any further delay, Taylor.
Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Taylor. Yes, as Mr. Cooley said, I didn't know that I would be speaking today. So, you know, my story is not, I don't have a story that's great like all the other ones. But I'll just talk about, you know, what I've been through, I guess. I'll do that. Because I do have some interesting things that I could say. First, before I go into that, I would like to thank Mr. Cooley from the bottom of my heart. Mr. Cooley came into my life, when I was a junior, about midway through my junior year, I met Mr. Cooley, and I didn't know how close we would get, you know, at that time, of course. But Mr. Cooley is like a father to me, and without him, I would not have the confidence that I do now. Because if any of you have known or have heard me speak before, I grew up with my father in my life, but It was a very, very toxic relationship. And he's still in my life, which, you know, yeah, whatever. So Mr. Cooley has definitely took the father role in my life, and I love you and I thank you for that, Mr. Cooley. So, as you know, I'm going to Spelman, which is a black college. It's called HBCU, which is a historically black college university. And Spelman is the number one in the country. And I like to let people know because I wanted to go to Howard University in DC, which is number four. And then I went to Spelman and it just changed my mind. So what I would like to do, or I'm a psychology major, or I will be a psychology major, excuse me. And I aspire to be a psychiatrist. I plan to go to Howard's Medical School after, you know, I complete my undergrad at Spelman. What else do I have to say? Okay, I recently got accepted into, well, okay, Spelman is very competitive. It's an all-girls school. You know, and when I tell you it's an all-girls school, all these girls, they have a 3.5 and above. So me going, I have a 3.6. Like, I'm not, you know, I'm not crazy above the line, but I didn't know if I would get into Spelman. And I went there in April for this thing called Spellbound, which is like Admitted Students Week type thing. And I had an interview with a program called the Rise Start Program. And it is a internship that goes through the whole summer, or excuse me, a month of the summer. And it's a summer of biomedical and behavioral science research. And as a psychology major, of course, like that's what I want to do. And I had to interview for it, I had to apply for it, I needed letters of recommendation. And it was between about 20 incoming freshmen and sophomores who are already at Spelman. So at the interview, I'm like stressing out because all these girls had some type of experience in the medical field and all that, and I have nothing, like I've done nothing. This one girl did research at Johns Hopkins. And I'm sitting there like, I have nothing to offer but other than my positive attitude and desire to learn, you know. But I got the internship, and I'll be leaving. Thank you. Because I was so scared. I didn't think I would do it. But I leave June 5th, and I'm very excited. You know, Atlanta is a completely different place from California. And I'm very excited. I'm an only child, so I'll be leaving my mom, which will be hard, but Mr. Cooley and Mrs. Cooley have another family set up for me in Atlanta that's waiting for me. So yeah, that's all I have to say. And thank you all for listening.
Taylor do not know that Spelman, my mother-in-law right here, and Michelle's family, her cousin was the chancellor at Spelman and Morehouse a few years back. So her cousins and strong ties are still there. So we are going to keep an eye on you. I'm going to have Tabitha to come up real quickly. And she didn't know that I was going to call her up either. But, you know, it would be remiss if I didn't bring all of my seniors up here.
Okay. Well, I kind of saw this coming. I just hoped it wasn't. So I don't really have that much to say. I don't have a message or anything. So I'll just talk a little bit about myself, because why not? So, yeah, I'm going to UC Davis next year. That's pretty cool. Yeah, just about myself. I'm a pretty happy person, except in the mornings. Just not my thing. But even when I'm not happy in the mornings, I just go around and I go like, hey, everyone, like, good morning. All my friends say I'm like a cheerful person. Like, you can talk to me about whatever. It's great. School's good. I really like school, except now because I have senioritis. Just like, whatever. But I'm still going through. I'm not like a procrastinator or anything because I took marching band for 3 years and we had practices every day of the week, even Saturdays. And so whenever, like, because you had to practice all the time, and so you have to make sure that you get your work done. And so because of marching band, I'm, like, totally not a procrastinator, which is cool because it's useful. Even this year, because I didn't do marching band, because I'm allergic to my mouthpiece now of the trumpet. I played the trumpet, and I'm allergic to my mouthpiece now. So I didn't play this year, but I did join choir because I was like, I like art and music and stuff. So I was like, okay, I'll do it. Why not? So I did that, and that was fun. But it's coming to an end, which is good because that class is starting to annoy me too, because I'm a senior, and all my classes are starting to annoy me. And yep, I'm done.
Wow. Notice I said that I had 6 seniors. You only heard from 5 of them. And notice I left a blank at number 3 that was on the page. I did that on purpose, by the way. First of all, this other senior that I'm going to bring up to the stage is very dear to me because I got to keep him focused. I see big things coming out of here. I see big things coming from all of you. Keep that in mind. We had to put a little bit more work in this one to make sure that that everything came out as planned. He do not know this yet, but he is the recipient for the Temecula's Dollars for Scholars, which is Monday. And he will be awarded another scholarship in front of about 6,000 people. But today, we're going to recognize him because he is one of the seniors that has truly, truly deserved and earned a scholarship from the J.C. Cooley Foundation. I want to read something to you real quickly, if I can. You come and read it, baby. This is his appointment letter to West Point.
United States Military Academy of West Point, Certificate of Appointment. On behalf of the President of the United States of America and the United States Military Academy Admissions Committee, I take great pleasure in presenting this Certificate of Appointment to Desmond Lorenzo Young, Jr. for the class of 2020.
We're going to get a couple of pictures, and then we're going to do some more. DJ, I told you the last 4 months to maintain the faith, stay focused, stay positive, and I told you we would get there. Well, today we are there.
Uh-oh, let's get this right.
On this side, DJ. Also, on this side, DJ. Also, just like I have awarded the other 6 seniors. Also, another senior will be awarded her scholarship, which she's already been awarded it here. Tabitha, she will be awarded her scholarship in about 2 weeks in front of about 3,000 or 4,000 folks as well. So, but without any further ado, the J.C. Cooley Foundation would like to offer Desmond Young. Say, yeah, I know you want me to put the Lorenzo and all that stuff in there. Desmond Lorenzo Young, a scholarship based on perseverance, drive, most importantly, the seed. You remember what the seed is, right? Confidence, energy, and drive. A couple of things about him. DJ broke his leg last year, hand last year, during football season. And he had to sit it out. And, you know, a lot of times my son broke his hand and he never recovered. He didn't want to go back on the field. A lot of kids do that. But DJ loved football so much. And he had that drive. And for his academics, I don't have to say a whole lot. You can just look at his parents right here that he was going to do that. But it's an amazing, amazing accomplishment to get accepted to one of the service academy. It just doesn't happen like that. And I am so proud of you. And just like I said, I look for big things from you. And I'm sure your parents and all of us in here as well are looking for great things from you. But without any further delay, let's offer him a $500 scholarship to help out on some of his bills. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me tell you, the foundation, we got a lot of, our goal this year was to give away 16 scholarships. We have given away 9 so far. We do have additional scholarships that we are sowing through, but we had to make sure that we gave out the ones that was designated. We're working on that, so we still have a few smaller scholarships that we're going to be giving away, potentially to some folks that are in this room right now. All I have to say, especially the juniors in here, if you work hard, and just like Greg mentioned about the goals, he has some serious goals set early after last year. If you focus on these goals, I'm not just look at them and turn the page. Focus meaning that you have to take it and dissect it and figure out what it's going to take for you to achieve that portion of your destiny, which means it's a destination, just a stop. Got a lot of potential in here. But before we close this out, I was going to do a play. We'll wait to the next one. But I got to have Hashimi up to do one more song. I mean, it's mandatory. I mean, do you guys want him to come and do one as well? All right. The J.C. Cooley Phase 4 of the program starts the second week of July. It's going to be held here, probably in the whole restaurant. We own the whole restaurant. From 8 to 10 or 8 to 10:30. So we're going to increase it. We want to get everybody involved. We need to do some fundraising to raise money so we can continue to give out scholarships and do a lot of other different things. But we'll talk about that one. You ready? So any questions about anything during the time today, y'all, getting this set up? Great job.
So I'm going to leave the decision up to you guys. If you guys want a rock song or a rap song. So let me see. I heard that. But let me see you show of hands for a rock song. Who wants a rock song? Okay. Rock. Right? Rock. Okay. Rap. Oh, y'all lost, man. Dang. I am surprised. So not yet, but we're going to do Hero. Yeah, and man, I just want to say I am so impressed by the seniors, man. Give it up one more time for all the seniors. Wow, amazing. You have accomplished a great milestone in your life, and I commend you and honor you, and it's just a privilege to be a part of your celebration in your life. And so I'm excited, and I want to do a quick little plug, too. We've been doing high school, middle school, and college campus concerts. And we're trying to get one or two more in before the school year is over. I know that's only a few weeks. We're trying to get it in so we can shoot a really good promo video for our big fundraiser we're throwing in July. And so if you have connections at any kind of school, you want us to come in, we will bring the sound gear, the artists better than me. We'll throw on a free concert in your quad, in your gymnasium, whatever. But we'd like to book a couple more concerts before the school year's over. So if you're interested in that, come and see me. Otherwise, this song is called Hero. And bump that track. And y'all want to stand with me? Y'all, come on. Just stand with me. Turn that track up, DJ, and make sure you bring in my monitor. Yeah, okay. Yeah! Bring that track up. Go. Okay, yes. Yeah! It's better when I got a full band, but we'll make it happen. Let's go. Y'all ready? Okay. Flesh of my flesh, blood of my blood. I got one command.
hero, and his name is what? Supernatural hero, destined for victory, defeated the enemy. He came ready, made death bloody. Yes, he won the fight, all power and might. He overcame fortune and fame. He puts to shame those who claim the game. Blowing up the spot, hot dynamite. And nothing can stop him, not kryptonite. He ain't no Superman, I told you, man. Set your watchman, get off the road. Yes, yes, yo, I bring the heat, yo. Up to the street, yo. A supernatural is ready every day, ready every hour. It's the last round, rock steady, heavy power. Ready! Are you ready for this? Put your fist in the air if you're ready for this. Rock steady! Are you ready for this? Rock your fist like this if you're rolling with us. Ready, get ready! Hero is coming! Ready, get ready! Hero is coming! Wonders in the sky, people asking why. Well, I gotta live when I'm gonna die. Love is gone cold in the world we live in. You can call up on my hero when you need to live in. Yippee-ki-yay, welcome back to Earth. Dead, dead or alive, he's coming back from Earth. You can take him at his word if you're ready. Listen to me, never listen to the enemy. If this world is a disease, then my hero's got the cure. If this planet needs a savior, then my hero's the one with show. Stand strong with me, put your fist up high. Cause my hero is coming like a thief in the night. Ready? Are you ready for this? Put your fist in the air if you're ready for this. Rock steady! Are you ready for this? Rock your fist like this if you're rolling with us. Ready, get ready! Hero is coming! Ready, get ready! Hero is coming! Ready! Are you ready for this? Put your fist in the air if you're ready for this. Rock steady! Are you ready for this? Rock your fist like this if you're rolling with us. Yeah. Ready, get ready! Hero is coming! Ready, get ready! Hero is coming!
Yeah! All right. Got my vocal cords warmed up early in the morning. Hey, if you didn't get a free CD, they're right here. Help yourself, please. Got some more free CDs here. And some download cards on here is the link to download. That actually, every song I did today is available on free download with these cards. It's on SoundCloud. So love you guys, man. Go big. Dream big. James, thank you.
Did everybody have a good time? Hey. I want to thank my seniors again. I want to thank my seniors. Big things. One thing, I want to leave you guys with a parting message. Can we turn that down just a little bit? A parting message, seniors, seniors, seniors. This message is called the AIP. And take it to the heart because the A stands for expire. Aspire means that we see people on TV or in society or wherever you might see them, and you say, hey, I want to be just like that person based on sight recognition or something that you perceive. There's nothing wrong with that. However, let's make sure that we pick our role models carefully. Not just because you see something on TV or you see something appear to be a certain way. So, aspire is based on what I call the I inspired. A person do something to get you interested or et cetera, or you see something. That's okay as well. But in order for you to do it, it's going to require you to perspire. So, aspiration, which comes from inspiration, requires perspiration. That means you got to work for everything you do. Work for everything you do. Give it 100% in everything you do. Dream big. Think big. Be big. Thank you.
System didn't plan for this. Anomaly.
Anomaly.